GT Energy earnings projected to increase. Analysts expected higher profit for GT Energy. And the expected profit was 84 cents for that quarter, for the second quarter. As I read this one afternoon, didn't seem any different from the countless articles that I've read from Forbes or Wall Street Journal or Zacks. Seemed the same, except this was auto-generated. Narrative Science, the company behind it, takes data from different sources, and there's an artificial intelligence algorithm, machine learning algorithm, the area that I'm in, takes it and gives an article out. This is not the only company that does that. Associated Press uses a company called Automated Insights, takes data from different sources. Again, earnings announcements come out as bot generated. And the reason they do this is before, when they had, in early 2012, when they had human reporters doing these earnings announcements, they had just 30% coverage of all the earnings announcements. But with the bot generated, they now can do 70% with just bots and 10% with human reporters. And they're able to show that this actually increases trading activity. All of this is in an area called machine learning algorithms and artificial intelligence and deep learning applied to a context, an Amazon Go, where you can go into a store, grab things off the shelf, put it in your bag, walk out. No checkouts, no long lines. That's because of innovation in computer vision, sensor fusion, deep learning. Think about it in the context of IBM Watson, their supercomputer. They applied Watson supercomputer to diagnose a rare case of leukemia in a woman that doctors, human doctors, were stumped at. But Watson was spent 20 million cases, leukemia cases, and in 10 minutes, it was able to diagnose the form of cancer and suggest effective treatment. Fellow club members, esteemed Toastmaster, guest members, we are at the cusp of an exponential growth in machine learning algorithms that will be so pervasive in our society, it'll affect how we live, and it will affect our labor force. So when we're at this cusp, how do we prevent ourselves from getting obsolete? And more closer to my heart, the question is, how do we prevent our future generation to be successful and thrive in this innovative culture? So for this, I turned to experts in this field. And one particular researcher who resonated with me was Tony Wagner. Tony Wagner is an expert in residence from Harvard University. He's a fellow educator. He's also a high school teacher. And he's written several books, including Closing the Achievement Gap, Creating Innovators, and Who Will Succeed. And one thing about his research that quickly resonated with me, he's interviewed a lot of these very young innovators in their 20s from across the country with varied backgrounds, from different social economic privileges, from very high privileged kids to kids from poverty. The thing that stood out for him is one third of these kids had no recollection of a teacher who inspired them, but two thirds, they had a mentor. One third of them had a mentor in their lives, very important. But two thirds of these kids were able to identify a teacher, either through the elementary or through the higher schools, who were very inspirational to them. And then he went on to interview the teachers of all these identified teachers and mentors. And he identified five things that in our culture of schooling is so much in conflict to the culture of learning that we need to teach to our kids for an innovative future. First one is teamwork and collaboration. In our current schooling system, we celebrate and we reward individual achievement. The best spelling bee, the best National Geography bee. But in the real world out there, what innovators do is they work in a team, they collaborate rarely nowadays that you do something by yourself. It's always in a team. We need to tell kids how to do that. Number two, interdisciplinary or project-based. You cannot compartmentalize and say chemistry, biology, math has to be project-based and solve a particular problem, either with collaborating with someone else who's an expert in that field or learning some of it enough that you do a project-based. Third is risk-taking or iterative learning, where you teach kids to take risks and fail and learn from your failures. Kids are so scared these days to take risks and fail. So are the parents. The fourth is creating versus passive consumption of data. These kids sit in classrooms and they take in all this knowledge and they take it and passively consume it and do nothing about it. We need to teach kids how to create it. Take all that knowledge at the end of a project, create something, even a little small thing. And lastly, we need to teach them to be intrinsically motivated. Because all of these kids who are innovators, they all wanted to change the community, change the world for the better. And as I look into the future, sit in my driverless autonomous car, or I grab that package that the drone threw in front of my yard, or I go into Amazon and grab those things and put it in my shopping bag, the future looks exciting. But then I look at my kids, and I'm scared. I'm scared of how they will thrive. But instead of being so scared about the future, perhaps we need to take that as a challenge and learn to innovate ourselves and teach them that they need to learn to innovate as well.